Hello YouTube, thanks to your donations, we now got much better equipment. Everything is connected to the same system, so we can record videos for you. Still have a lot of work to do in terms of cameras and everything else, but so if this video will be useful, consider donation and consider maybe leaving a like. Alright, thank you. So this is Lenovo E590 USB Type-C jack repair. The main website is usbcrepair.com. Now here's the situation. You see that where it says like 100 bucks and 60 bucks on the screen. It doesn't apply to this motherboards at all. It's just for our primary business. You see, we are not an authorized Lenovo repair center. We are not authorized Acer or Asus or Dell or MSI or any other. Nobody authorized us anything for anything. But all of those five boards are still under warranty. All boards have a broken jack, broken jack, broken jack, broken jack right there, and broken jack. The reason they all under warranty is simple. If you look at the motherboard manufacturing date, you will see that it's made. Here, let me show you much closer. It's made 2019 or 2017. All right. Right there. That's the second one. So technically, all of those are still under, oh, well, this one is out of warranty, 2018. How about that one? 2019, okay. So all of those are under warranty. And the reason we basically state on our website, please don't send us those motherboards to us and don't send us any USB Type-C work, because we simply don't have time to handle USB-C repairs for several reasons. Now the reason we took this load on, because nobody was asking us if we wanna fix it or if we don't wanna fix it. We have a relationship with the primary authorized Lenovo repair centers, MSI repair centers, and Asus repair centers. Basically, if your Lenovo laptop breaks for something, screen damage or something else, you end up sending it under warranty to one of those repair centers. Software and screen replacements, they can handle it themselves. But for power jacks, all of those authorized repair centers, they send us the work. Especially if you're in the Midwest someplace, it's gonna come to us. Not you, but if the repair center is in the Midwest. So this repair center is authorized Lenovo repair center, and they send us usually most of the Lenovo power jacks for the repair. And in this situation, they send us the USB Type-C jacks for repairs, but before they sent it to us, I instructed each, because I can't refuse. You see, we got clients basically that constantly send us work. For example, school districts, governments of, you know, this and that, state police, state troopers, fire departments. I can't refuse that work. So even if it's not a power jack, they would send it to us. We're going to fix it. No big deal, because I can't lose a client. And here a repair center said, we have five boards under warranty which we need to fix in order to send back to the clients, and I can't refuse it, because I'm gonna lose the long-term relationship that we have with the Lenovo center. But for general clients, we don't really accept the repairs for several reasons. One is they have more than five motherboards, by the way, for the repair, but the only ones that they sent in to me is the ones that I instructed them that we will replace the jacks on the motherboards, and the jacks gonna conduct the electricity just fine. Each one they had to look for the physical damage to the jack itself. You see how this one is kind of bent right here at an angle. Let me show you a little bit closer. You see how it's bent? but the connections itself to the motherboard are not damaged. So if the connections are not damaged, we have a great chance of just replacing the jack and hoping it's gonna work. Now, the second problem with all of those jacks. So every one of those jacks doesn't have a damage to the motherboard anywhere in the back. So that's a good thing. And when the end client calls us, the end client cannot see if the damage is there or not there. Because if the damage is on the motherboard already, the trace comes off when you start to wiggle the plug back and forth. So when you start to wiggle the plug up, down, up, down, up, down, the traces in the back come off together with the jack, and nothing anybody can do about it. So those fives were selected because they don't have any damage in the back of the jack. So all of the, I will show you under the microscope in a second what I mean, but all of them have damage to the front of the jack itself. So we need to pop this guy off. Again, another damage. You see how damaged the front itself. All right. And another one damaged right here. You see? Now, the reason we don't accept USB-C ports at all at this time, maybe we're going to accept them in the future, is that even if you replace all of those jacks, even if you do a great job, even if everything is going to be soldered just fine, even if everything will be so nicely beautiful, the problem is some manufacturers, I'm not going to name names, put a counter onto a motherboard, and the counter is probably this component right there, or that component right there, all right? So what the counter does, it counts how many times you plugged in your plug into the motherboard. So you plug it in, one, plus one, plus one, plus one, plus one. And eventually, once the counter reaches like 1,000 or something, or 2,000, I don't know the exact number, I honestly don't know. Again, this is all conspiracy theories, but that's what my, how would I say, stupid brain, a guy who has a bachelor's degree in computer science, master's degree in computer science, many years of PhD work in computer science, designed a whole bunch of motherboards by myself, and manufactured many motherboards, but just like what we have in 2020, I kept putting the stamp that it's made in China instead of in the United States. I mean, doesn't matter what's made. Anyways, so in my conspiracy theory, some manufacturers, I'm not going to name names, I'm just saying some manufacturers that have USB Type-C jacks have this counter that counts how many times you plugged it in. And once you plugged it in too many times, in order for you to buy a new laptop, too many times, all right? So once you plugged it in too many times, the counter basically says to a handshake component, listen, dude, it's time for a new laptop, so no more handshakes. No more handshakes mean what? It means that there's going to be only 5 volts coming through the jack. 5 volts, 5 volts, 5 volts, 5 volts. If the handshake does not happen, it's going to be 5 volts. If the handshake happens, it's going to be 20 volts. And it will give it some time until 1,000s or 2,000s. Now, some manufacturers came up with the update. They increased the counter a little bit. But when it comes to the broken jack, the problem is you wiggle it, you wiggle it, you wiggle it, you wiggle it. So every time you wiggle it, it's one connection. So it's plus one, plus one, plus one, plus one, plus one. So by the time you found that sweet spot, you already 30 or 40 connections. The counter already increased 30 or 40 times. And the more you wiggle it, the faster the counter spins. And eventually it's the counter that stops working, basically, that stops making the handshake, not so much the jack. So for example, this jack doesn't seem to be that broken, you know, it looks good to me right there. So on this motherboard, to my understanding, it might be just a handshake. It might be that the counter said, you've been plugged in too many times. I don't want to work. On this laptop, there is much better chance that it's just a jack broken because I can see physical damage to the jack. This one is also, I can see physical damage. It's right there. I mean, it's pretty visible. This is also physical damage. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to start with the physical damaged ones. And the point of the story of this, let's say, fictional story, I don't want to get lawsuits against me. I went through a divorce recently. I don't want to go to courts anymore. So again, this is all a conspiracy theory and fiction. It's all fiction. So don't listen to me, guys. So the point is, once the count reaches like 1,000, 2,000, 3,000 plugins, it no more handshake, and doesn't matter how many times you're gonna replace this jack, it's not gonna work. And the problem is, this company has no fixed no charge policy, so we don't charge anything unless the laptop gonna work. And unfortunately, even if you replace the jack, if you waste our time replacing the jack, and it's not gonna work, we're out of money, out of jack, out of time. And we don't make a cent on that, all right? Not a single cent. Again, but in 2020, we only make money pretty much from donations, and pretty much that's about it. And some of those repairs for authorized factory Lenovo in this. And those authorized repair centers are pretty much, they service all of them, because Lenovo is based in Bratislava, in Slovakia. But due to corporate inversions, basically IBM opened a PO box in Bratislava, and they basically still operate from United States, but same as Alphabet, Google, same as Arthur Andersen, Accenture, and, you know, the standard. So in order to pay less tax, so to speak. Anyways, so let's begin with one of the jacks. I want to start with the worst jacks, because this is a good jack, meaning doesn't look that bad. So I will set this guy aside. All right. This looks bad. Anyways, let's start with this one, because that one looks bad. Let's see how many boards gonna work after I'm done with all five of them. Now, I'm not gonna be able to get all five of them here today on the video, because it's really a long process to get each one properly soldered, desoldered. Now, things to remember. When it comes to USB-C repairs, you will see a whole bunch of black components. In the back of the jack, in the back of the motherboard. Now, if any one of those black components is going to fly off the motherboard, you are pretty much done. So what you need to do is, you need to do a lot of preparation. You can't just put a Captain tape on top of it. You have to use Captain tape, yeah, but first you have to put foil here. First you're going to put foil. Well, this side doesn't have any black components that can fly off the motherboard, but this side seems to have a crack in the motherboard. No. It all looks good. So here, we're just gonna use the foil on the back right here, and a little bit right there, but the most of the foil has to be on this side. So let's see if I'm gonna have it on foil someplace here. Right, so we got a piece of foil. All right. A piece of foil, which we're gonna just tear out like that and put it onto right there like that. Yeah, you know what, I can even fold it so that So prep work takes a lot of time. I see people just, you know, go at it, but I know that if one of those components gonna get blown off the motherboard, it's money lost for me. So here, what I wanna do now is run some Captain tape on top of that foil. And the Captain tape is an extra layer that prevents the prevents the heat coming to the motherboard. Like that, like that, like that. Good job. Okay. And let's see. Let's try. Okay, good job. And here, well, I think that's gonna be all right. And what I wanna do is I wanna put a little piece of foil onto the light, the indicator light, which almost always flies off the motherboard when it's in such a close proximity to the jack. So just to show you here, you see this light right here? That yellowish thing right here? This guy flies off the motherboard all the time. So instead of using Kapton tape, make sure to use foil. Make sure to use foil. Like that. And let's tape it down. Like that. And like that. Alrighty. That's good. Let me show you close up. So you see how well I insulated. First I insulated with the foil, and then I put some Kapton tape. Again, Kapton tape, the link to the Kapton tape is on the bottom of the in the description. Here what you want to do is you want to remove the foil slightly from the connection, because when I'm going to be using hot air, this whole thing not going to be all right. So the biggest problem on those jacks is that the rear pins, there's a 12 pins right here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. And 12 right there. Those pins get stuck in the motherboard, and it's really tough to clean up every one of those holes, but I'm always trying. So it's better not to break this guy apart altogether, but remove the entire assembly on the hot air station so that all of it would drop. So the first thing I want to do in this situation is add a lot of flux right here, then add a lot of solder, leaded base solder, not silver base solder. Leaded base solder has a much lower melting temperature, so on the hot air is gonna mix with the leaded solder, and it will allow me to drop the jack first. Then I'm gonna add a whole bunch of flux right there. Some solder right here, right here, right here, right there. And it's supposed to be dropped from the motherboard. So let's begin. Let's see if I'm gonna be lucky. Again, likes eventually if the video is gonna be enjoyable. Now I'll power up the exhaust, it's gonna be loud. So I got a whole bunch of noise suppressors built into here, thanks to your donations again. And hopefully that's gonna improve the whole situation experience. Okay, so let's begin. It would help a lot if I would be 20 years younger and my eyesight would be the best ever. But since I'm already old, can't see much. But for the soldering, I don't really need that much zoom. So let's... I added some flux. Now I'm gonna add some solder, fresh leaded solder, to the top side. All right. Right, so the leaded solder gonna mix with the silver based solder, because as you can see, there is that whole solder on the motherboard. It's all leaded based solder. Silver based solder. Let's see. Alrighty, so now that all of the solder is mixed together, what I'm gonna do is set up this little raising bench, and we're gonna drop down the hot air station right there, like that. Like that, and we're gonna start with the low temperature, and then we're gonna slowly increase the temperature until this whole jack gonna fall off the motherboard. And the goal is to help it with the soldering iron. And I'm keeping the distance between the hot air station, the hot air nozzle. And we mostly need to warm up this quadrant, not the opposite one. I mean, this one is no big deal. And the goal is I want it to drop by itself. That way it will take out most of the... You know what I forgot to do? I forgot to flux the other side. The other side is right there. You need to put a whole bunch of flux in the back. Okay, right there, you see? So we're gonna flux it up a little bit. Now we're gonna flux up this side. This side right there. And now we're gonna use the hot air to remove everything. You see how it's starting to drop already? This is a good sign. Now we're gonna flip it over. And we're gonna use the hook to see if it's gonna go or if it's not gonna go. All right, you don't wanna force it. You wanna make sure that it drops by itself. All right. Have to be slightly quicker than this. Right, you see, it dropped off. Alrighty. Now, we're not done with the hot air, simply because we still need to keep the air flowing, because we got solder to pick up from the motherboard. And we start on this side. And we're using a desoldering wick. The link to the wick is in the description below. Like that. Like that. All right. Come on, doesn't want to come out. All right, so here what we do is Just suck up as much as possible. All right. All righty. And on this end, all right, so what I'm trying to do is suck all of the solder from the connections. And what I need to do is use a whole bunch of flux in the back. Remember, I said to move the foil as far as possible from this rear leg. Well, I was right, it would be a problem. So what I need to do is I need to fill up that hole one more time and use a much smaller soldering rig to get this guy out of there. All right, this doesn't want to go through very well. Let's try one more time. Let's fill up this hole. Let's fill up that hole. Let's fill up both of those holes. Now let's use the hot air right under. Let's cut the right, so now what I need to do is I need to do the same cleanup on the other side right there. Okay. Good job. And I need to clean every one of those traces right there. All right. Now, enough of the hot air. Shut down the hot air. All right, so here is the big picture. Pretty much the traces in the back are mostly cleaned up. Yeah. Yeah, we don't have any damaged traces whatsoever. Looks perfect to me. Looks really good. All right, so what I want to do now, I want to inspect each one of those traces to make sure that all of them are empty. I needed to clean the hole first. Okay, so what you see here is just the flux. Alrighty. Another thing I want to make sure is something is right here. Okay, and I got something stuck right there. It's probably also the case right here. All right, so it's clean from that side. Let's flip it over. Yep, everything seems to be empty on this side. This trace on the side right here has more solder inside than I would like, but the rest of them seems to be fine. I wonder if this solder is on this side or is that solder on that side. Let's see. Maybe it's not solder, maybe just some flux. Let's see. Yeah, it was just... No, well, hard to say. Could be flux, could be not. Oh. Alrighty. So what am I to do now? I need to clean this thing up. Okay. See, beautiful. Nothing's damaged. So that would be a good example that once I put a new jack, if it's not gonna work, that means this motherboard has a counter built into it. So just keep watching if this thing gonna work or not. Alright? Alright, so for this connection, I'm gonna use this liquid flux. Alright. Now we got the jacks right here. Let's start with the first one. We sell the jacks for this laptop on our website. The link is below. Like that. So what you wanna do is you wanna position it perfectly straight downwards. All right. Okay, the goal here is to make sure, I'll have a hard time soldering those pins in the back right there. That's gonna be a pain. Anyways. You wanna make sure that all of the pins You want to make sure that all of the pins came through the motherboard, right? And now what I want to do is, while pressing down here, put some solder right there and some solder right there. So right here and right there. That way I would be able to secure it in place. So let's add some solder. Let's add some solder while I'm putting the pressure on top of the jack. Okay. Now I want to double check that all of the positions in the back are perfectly set. Yeah, they all of them sit perfectly fine. So now I want to add some more solder on the other side of the jack while pressing the whole assembly downwards. You know what? First, I needed to add some solder to the soldering iron. I was more concerned about pressing on it downwards. All right, looks good to me. And let's add another one right here. All right, and since we already added, let's add another one in the front. Now, just a tiny bit. You don't want to overdo it, because once the solder gets into this hole, you are done pretty much. So make sure that this excess right there isn't there. Make sure to suck it out with the soldering wick any day now. So let's suck this guy from here. All right, so we did suck it. Okay, so before I solder the bottom, I need to make sure that I would be able to solder the rear back for one simple reason. And that is, there is not much room to operate right there, you see? No room whatsoever. So the goal is to put it on the pad, lower down the microscope, so that at least I would be able to see what I'm doing. Let's focus the microscope. And let's try to solder this baby up. All right. All right, so for that I will need a different soldering iron. And I will probably need to use a different flux. Well, let's try this flux first, the one I just used. Okay. Let's see if I would be able to get the job done with this. Let's just try one of those. doesn't seem to work as well as I was hoping. So you know what, I need to remove this little nuance. Come on. All right, need to find something sharp. Sharp and grubby. Here. Okay, good job. All right, let's keep going while the flux is still there. Nope, it doesn't do anything. You know what? Here. Let's use a different flux. Let's use this guy. Okay. Let's see how well that flux is gonna operate in those conditions here. All right. Let's refocus a little bit. All right, good job. Let's try the rest of it. Problem here is I don't want to make a breach with the casing. Casing is also metal.
All right. Basically, working on the microscope is exhaustive work. All right, so the last pin on the right is not soldered, definitely. The left pin here, left most probably not soldered. So let's try one more time the last few pins right there. Okay, let's do one more time. Okay. Eventually, I'm gonna get through to what I need to solder right there. Come on, please. Come on, kick in. Need more solder. If I had more solder, it's just not gonna fit in there. And I am afraid for a breach. That's a huge blob. Looks good. Alrighty, let me drop this thing down. Hard to see under such a huge angle. Okay, now it looks good. Whew. So much pressure. All right, let's change the angle on the microscope to the bottom view. Straight bottom. Let's focus the lights. Now let's focus the focus. Right there. Beautiful. I love when everything is so beautifully aligned. Now let's solder up the side two legs right here. All right, another one right there. All right, another one right here. Another one right there. Good job. Now let's add more solder to the iron. All right. And now we just need to fix the, not the fix, but we need to solder the bottom portion. Let's use the liquid flux first. If it's not gonna pick up well, I'm gonna be using the different flux. Alrighty. I should probably change the iron here, not this one, to do something different. Okay, so that's that much for that iron. Let's try smaller iron. See if the smaller iron gonna pick up. That's a huge blob. Let's see if the smaller iron gonna be able to pick up right where I need it to pick up. Okay. All right, looks good to me. Even though I'm not factory authorized, but the factory authorized is gonna be sending work my way anyway, so at least I have to do something for it, since I can't say no. All right, so let's clean this mess up. All right, so we still need to solder on this side this top left side. Okay. You see, this part right here needs still to be soldered. Still need to be soldered, so let's use some plugs here. And let's try our big soldering iron and see if it's gonna pick up. Let's see. Nope, it doesn't want to pick up. Let's try smaller soldering iron. Honestly, don't enjoy blobs like that big. So let's remove some. Okay, like that. And let's do this side as well. Still doesn't want to penetrate into that. Okay. Good job. All right, so let's clean up one more time. All right, so that's the final result, how the solder looks like on the bottom. And it looks good to me. And here I'm just gonna clean up a bit more. As you can see, none of the black components in the back flow of the motherboard. You see how many of them under the microscope? And hopefully, you know what I want to do? I want to just double check that each one of those guys is solder through. Usually the peak gonna show you which one is moving left or right. And in this case, all right, so all of them checked out. And let's see under this angle, maybe. And none of them seem to be shorting Yeah, none of them are shorting with the casing. The casing is also metal, you see, on the top. But in this 3D, by the way, thanks to your donations, we finally got the 3D microscope. We wish it would have a much bigger screen because I'm watching right now. I'm looking into the screen all day, every day. All right, and that's the way how it's done on the top. Obviously, I could have done more solder right here on the on this thing. It just, I know that the plastic gonna melt, and I don't want the jack to be compromised. Basically, when the jack goes in, the plug goes into the jack. If that solder gonna penetrate inside of the jack, it's gonna be a mess. And that's on the bottom here. All right. Alrighty, so I let it dry a little bit, and now what I want to do is I want to double check if there is no, what's that from? Oh, that's from the pen. I want to see if you get any shortages on the positive rail, and the positive rail is the rail number 4. Nope, we don't get any shortages here. Alright, so that's 1.7. 1.7, that's a negative. All right, so that's supposed to be negative, but that gives me resistance for some reason. Oh, okay, so that's the negative, okay. And that's the negative. 2, 3. The problem is the number 3 supposed to be a handshake. No, it's number 4. Okay, so number 3 is a handshake, gives me 4 ohms. Number 4 is the positive end. Here, let me show you. So when we're looking on the bottom rail, so this is negative. Number 1 is a negative, 0 ohms. Zero resistance now. The first one, go figure what that is. Data signal of some sort. Number 3 is the handshake, right? I think. Number 4. Is a plus. Data signal of some sort. 1, 2, 3, 4. So that's also a handshake. And this. No, that's a plus and that's a handshake. There. Okay. All right. And let's take a look if on the other side we get the plus as well. Can't get to it because of the metal piece on the top. Anyways, let's try to see if this whole thing gonna work. Okay, so here we got the USB-C reader that should give us, you know what, how about I'm gonna disconnect it here. I will connect it there. Okay, looks like connected, okay. And now we're gonna plug this guy in. And we had 5 volts, and now it switched to 20 volts. So 20 volts going in like that. Now let's unplug it, let's plug in that way. And nothing. So it's only does a good job when it's going that way. So only upside up. So this system gonna work 50% of the time. Not sure why it doesn't wanna do the other way. Maybe my plug isn't working well here. You know what I think? Is it possible that this thing is bad? Okay, let me find another. Just give me 1 second. All right, so we got another tester right here. Let's plug in. Let's plug in without damaging the motherboard, right? So let's test this guy out. All right, and here we got 20 volts, 0.32 amps, but it should give me 2 amps, not 0.32 amps. So, but the handshake happening, so that's a good thing.
But two amps would probably happen if let's flip it over. What do we have? 5 volts. Oh, so we get 20 volts and 0.33 amps. Oh, strange. So my other tester went bad. Yeah, no. All right, so this is a good indication that everything should work fine. I hope. Yeah. Wow. All right, so let's do the other four. All right, so this board should work fine. Now the question is, will the other four work fine? I already put one insulation, two insulation, three insulation, and four. This one I still need to insulate. But the point is, I don't know for sure how it's all gonna work until the client gets it back, until the Lenovo authorized repair center gonna get the motherboards from me back to install them into the client's laptops, and then they're gonna tell me if they're gonna work or not. Because right now you can see that one of my testers, this Chinese stuff, only work 50% of the time, probably because I wear it out over time, and maybe because some of the maybe I need a new one of those. And but the other tester right here, this one showed me that it's good regardless if I plug it in like that or like that, because sometimes it goes only one way. So 50% of the time it would work like that, but when you flip it over, it's not gonna work. Again, not sure. We will see. Anyways, you can read in the description to this video how many of those boards in fact worked and how many of them didn't. Thank you so much for watching. Please leave a like, subscribe, and you guys stay safe and have a good day. Thank you. Bye.